हे बड़ी हाय व्हाट्सअप।
ए अक्षय सर एंड अ वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू यू एंड वी थैंक यू फ्रॉम द डीपेस्ट ऑफ आवर हार्ट बिकॉज़ यू टुक आउट टाइम फ्रॉम योर सो
थैंक यू
बिजी
बड़ी,
शेड्यूल एंड यू नो गेव अस दिस टाइम एंड
नॉट प्रॉब्लम, थैंक यू।
वी हैव बीन रियली लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड टू दिस
सो एम आई, ऑसम।
या सो लेट्स जस्ट क्विकली इंट्रोड्यूस Mr. Akshay. So Akshay sir is the creator and the driving force behind one of India's fastest growing startups, Leverage Edu, which empowers students across India to choose the best matched careers and higher education options with one-touch access to personalized mentors and leading global universities. He is one of the Forbes 30 Under 30 Asia and India and is also a CNBC Young Turk Award recipient. He is also selected as the Prime Minister's Champion for Change and is one of the top tech entrepreneurs to look out for in the year 2020. We welcome you, sir, to
Thank you, buddy.
This event, this short webinar
Very high
that we
praise.
have.
Not sure how relevant, but yeah.
Thank you. So, we'll quickly move on to our first question, which is all about you. So, we all know about, we all use iPhones, but we don't know much about, you know, Jobs or Wayne or Wozniak's garage hustle.
Hmm.
So, how has your journey been like from your early days as an aspiring entrepreneur to this stage where you have, you know, created something very big, like Leverage Edu?
Sure. So, I think Shudhanshu, first of all, again, thank you so much for having me. Really appreciate it's great to speak with all of you here. I can't imagine having a better Sunday than being amongst aspiring folks like you guys are. So I think let me kind of one thing that I'm a big fan of is that I think you and I both are very lucky, and so is the entire cell here. We are very lucky to be building a company in the day and age that we are today. I think you mentioned Jobs, Wayne, and Wozniak. I think these guys had it much tougher back in the day. Today we have all the resources that we want to at our peril. When I wanted to start a business, I knew that, okay, while my cash was limited, I could go on and kind of take a seat at my friend's co-working space. Then I could essentially work from lobby of a five-star hotel. Then eventually I took up an office, not a garage exactly, but which was in front of a Daru Gadda. And that was fun for the first year as well. And so I think while, of course, the hustle part remains, the 0 to 1 part is very exciting. It is very, it's a mix of encouragement and discouragement both. After the first 15 days, excitement kind of goes out and you realize that it's shut up, shut down. It's a dhanda in some sense and you got to stick it out. Perseverance is going to be more important than your talent is. The ability to kind of solve a different problem, the ability to communicate that problem, the ability to kind of communicate your solution to the people who you want to join, the ability to get the first few customers. So all of those things are going to be far more important than the initial deal to start up a business. So was it for me. And I think everything that I'd done previously kind of really helped me to get to that point. The fact that I'd worked in a bunch of startups before starting up, that helped me. The fact that I had a bunch of friends I had made who helped me hire the first 5 or 7 or 10 employees at Leverage Edu, that really helped. So did the same setup when I was kind of raising funds for the first time when we raised an Angel/Seed round about 3.5 years back now. So I think without that ecosystem, without that setup, of course, it would have been slightly more lonelier, difficult, would have taken 6 to 8 months more. But yeah, I think the perseverance that you need to kind of have in those early stages really makes all the difference. And so for example,
you,
just to kind of relate it out, the fact that anybody in this coterie, like you already will have all of you to support each other. And if any of you are kind of starting up, you know that, okay, I can vouch on my friends to introduce me to a couple of more people to kind of build the first prototype or kind of help me get the first set of initial customers, be it college going students, be it some enterprises, because everybody will have that connection. And hence, I think being at college and great that you guys are essentially doing this together as a society, because I really believe the whole, the biggest advantage that you should have at college and the biggest takeaway from college after you graduate should be that you have about 100 plus numbers on your speed dial. people who you need anything from, be it opening more gates to a possible opportunity, be it hiring employees, like I said, be it getting funds. Those 100 people should be on your speed dial to say that, "Arey yaar, bata, kaam kya hai?" And if you're not doing that, even getting an 8 or 9 GPA on 10 or whatever, 4 on 5 or whatever it is, I think it's pretty useless in my opinion. Sorry, long answer to a short question, but I wanted to kind of throw a different perspective on. I did not wanted to kind of bore you with everybody's struggles. I think, yeah, everybody struggles, but I think entrepreneurs today, yeah, of course, there are shares of up and down, but I think you struggle much less as compared to anybody else.
Okay. So, did you actually, you know, read books on entrepreneurship, or is it just, you know, it comes naturally?
No, all the time. I think it's not just I did read. I think I read even today. Every stage that we are at, in fact, I have the Y Combinator page opened up on one of my tabs. Even right now, I was looking at some aspects about scaling businesses using inorganic growth marketing efforts. I still kind of go out and engage in sessions that master growth guys take across the world. I was in one which, and I'll share the link with this group. One which the head of growth at Airbnb was taking about, I think, 2 weeks back, organized with one of the product groups here in Bangalore. So I think book reading, note keeping, podcast reading has to be consistent, because I think the first rule of entrepreneurship or the first rule of starting up is that you are promising yourself that you will keep on improving your style, your leadership ability, every single day. Otherwise, you will grow very quickly, because you don't have the skills of scaling a company from 10 people to 50 people, or 50 people to 100 people, or 100 to 500 people. You have to essentially build those skills, and that is best learned either by kind of reading books or by engaging people who have essentially seen it before and understanding things from them. And of course, all of that done together will be only 10%. The remaining 90% will be execution, and how you execute it very, very carefully, keeping your original style and context with it. So, yes, but I very actively encourage tapping onto all possible entrepreneurial resources that you can get your hands on. I'm a very big proponent on that.
Okay. So lately we've also been hearing that, you know, being jugadu is a very big part of an entrepreneur's life. So,
absolutely.
Do you agree to that?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, 100%. Matlab, even more so when you're trying to build a business in India, I've had random people, like in the first year of business, I've had police coming to our office because a brick and mortar competitor kind of complained against us that we shouldn't be essentially in that locality opening up an office there. I've had people spamming us like nobody's business, thinking that, okay, internet business can be easily spammed and made a fraud out of. We've had a phishing scam, which essentially almost wiped away all the money that we had in the bank. All of those things happened in the first year. So if you're not essentially thinking over your feet and being very careful in the first 6 to 12 months, it's a very difficult place to be at. Yeah. Even especially in India, I think, because in India, you already have a set established playbook slash rules that are there in the prevalent industry. And if you play around with that industry, if you play around with the so-called brick and mortar entrepreneurs from the previous generation, they don't really like it. They don't really like to be disrupted. So if you're a disruptor, of course, you're going to fall in some trouble along the journey. But that's the fun. That's why you do it right.
Yeah, of course. So moving on to the next question.
Sure.
What are your tips for the young entrepreneurs who want to start up or start off after this lockdown? Like, how do you think will the business world change?
Sure. Well, I think what's very important, let me break this down into two steps. I think the first step is obsessing over the customer like nobody's business, right? Like nobody's business. Like going into the very minutest detail of what the consumer does. Because... And why I'm saying this is because there are still many opportunities which are available in the nooks and corners of kind of solving this problem. For example, say there is a Zomato or a Swiggy out there which delivers food, right? But there are a lot of things which can be solved on at the Kirana merchant stand. Be it in terms of organizing how he or she keeps their stock, be it in terms of how their delivery happens from their wholesaler, be it in terms of once the food reaches our end, How do we essentially go about making it, consuming it in a contactless way? We, right now, we're kind of just keeping everything out for 12 hours, so on and so forth. So every business is kind of seeing a lot of changes. Say, in terms of online learning, while there are a lot of businesses who are kind of doing the same thing and saying, okay, I'll get some teachers, I have the software out there, and I'll just kind of start people to teach random courses, be it a coding, be it a Java, be it English, be it whatnot. But that's not the innovation, right? The innovation is going to be, can I essentially jump into the nooks and corners of what this consumer is actually looking for or actually trying to solve for? Maybe they don't have the right device to look at, to kind of consume these online learning sessions. Can I essentially do a hardware innovation and create a very cheap device on which the entire country can consume online learning now? Can I essentially or build a software which will make it very easy, extremely easy for anybody and everybody to go out and open an online learning shop on, and then I become the aggregator of all online learning that is going to happen and then not compete with all the online learning shops that are happening. So I think what is very important is to not get, of course, get inspired from journeys of other people, but not get too inspired by the business models. And always think about what exactly do I need to solve, which really strikes a chord with me and which really will kind of help me be really happy solving this for at least 10 years in my lifetime. Because startup is essentially a 10-year journey at the very minimum, even if you're not looking to kind of be married to it for the entire life. So you have to be very sure about the problem that you're solving and you're massively in love with it. And even more so, think of it as, is it going to be relevant at least 5 years from now? So a sneak peek into the future is kind of what differentiates the best entrepreneurs from the not so great entrepreneurs. And I think we have seen that. I think Elon Musk is a living example of that, right? Like when he started SpaceX, everybody abused him and hurled him. And this guy was not coming from a space background. So with Tesla as well, right? Like he took on Tesla from the founders after Tesla had been there in operation for 4 to 5 years. But he had a different way of solving it. And he really kind of solved the real problem for the consumers by spending enough time with them. And history is there to kind of, we have seen what has happened. So yeah,
of course.
Consumer obsession figuring out what problem to solve and seeing how is it going to be relevant 3, 4, 5 years down the line as the new word, as the new normal takes over.
Like we've seen with most of these startups, like their stories is like what people have gone through. Like the founder of Ola, he did not have a way to communicate to his work, so he started off with Ola. So it's essentially solving a problem that you think is very relevant to you as well.
Correct. So let me kind of further kind of spend a minute on that. So there are two kinds of entrepreneurs. One would be folks who are missionary in nature, who would essentially solve problems that are best for them. And second will be people who say that, okay, yaar, I want to run a business. And a lot of people who would be in e-cell would not have an idea right now, would not have a problem that they completely personally identify with. And that's fine too, where you essentially drop those 10 problems and say that, okay, for these 10 problems, this is the market size. There are not enough competitors right now, or there are competitors who I can disrupt and I can have a free run in this space for the next 5 years and build something. And still I can have like people believe in me. Not just to kind of fund me, but to also help people kind of join me, get the first few clients, so on and so forth. And both the ways are right. So the first way is kind of a missionary way to build a business. Second way is a more orchestrated, structured way to build a business. And both ways are right. So you could be on either of the sides.
Okay. So moving on. The next question is, what do you think the startup of the future will look like?
Sure, interesting. So I think I'll just pick up from where I left it in the last answer. Startup of the future will essentially be solving much smaller problems than startups of the previous decade. For example, in the decade before us, we were solving for food discovery. When Zomato and a host of others were all solving for food discovery, right? Or we were solving for restaurants. So some of the best food entrepreneurs either opened restaurant chains or folks like Dipinder essentially went out and opened food discovery platforms. And then sometime in the middle of this decade, we shifted to food delivery. Now within food delivery also, there are going to be like 10 different minute aspects which can essentially make food delivery a much better space. And those are the places that people are going to solve for. Can I build a software for food delivery folks to kind of do their business in a slightly better way than they are today? And food delivery is still a random example because there are two leading players in India now. But imagine other spaces where there are 4, 5, 6, 10 leading players and all of them are heavily funded. Can I rather make a software which can essentially help all of these guys do their business in a better way? Right? For example, I'm not sure if you guys have heard this story, but there's a story, right, about ek gaon tha, gaon ke andar ek jagah thi, wahan pe kafi logon ne bola ki sona ikhatta ho gaya hai. And ek sabne kaha chalo yaar raat ko 3 baje sona khodne chalte hain, khatam ho jayega. So these are all the entrepreneurs essentially who are running after the big so-called glamorous ideas per se or the glamorous places. But there was this one smart guy who said, yaar, theek hai, sona wona to milega. Meri to favde ki dukaan hai. You understand what a favda is, right? Jisse khodte hain. So wo us jagah ke bahar jahan pe sona khod raha tha, wo uske bahar khada ho gaya.
Yeah.
Usse favda bekna shuru kar diya. Kaafi logon ne usse favda kharida, jaake sona nikala, all of that. But jitne bhi logon ne sona nikala, none of their net wealth or net impact was not as much as this guy who was selling the favda to everybody. Because he figured out that I can help all of these guys who are trying to essentially run after those things. So hence, success might not be where you're exactly, it might not be in the exact areas in which you're kind of focusing on right now. So hence, I'll go back to the same thing, go deeper into the consumer problem and figure out what can kind of really help you solve it to the very core. Like this guy has identified that, yeah, favde ki sabko zarurat hogi. So can I essentially go ahead and identify today, like all the edtech businesses, this is what they want to solve for. Can I help them give the software? Or all the, commodity buying guys, can I help them with this? Or all the guys who essentially sell their fashion online, can I like a Myntra, like Mukesh Bansal did that, right? He essentially gave them a platform. So think about how you can essentially make life easier for other entrepreneurs or essentially go much deeper onto solving for the minutest aspects for this consumer, which Dunzo did, right? Dunzo did with, otherwise Dunzo wouldn't have existed in a space where Zomato and Swiggy were already there. And now Swiggy is kind of role reversing and trying to do the same thing that Dunzo is doing with some of their specific features. So yeah, I think that's where the key is, kind of going deeper into the whole consumer journey and just understanding what really solves it for the person at the other end. Yes.
So next up we have, this is a good one. Higher education in India versus higher education abroad.
Oh.
What are your thoughts? Is a better option seeing the current circumstances?
See, this is, there's no one better than the other. It depends on what you're doing right now. So for example, if somebody's somebody's kind of done their undergrad and looking for their master's, if they're looking to do a STEM master's, if they're looking to do management, of course, they should look at India first if they don't have any work experience under their hood. And they should look at kind of cracking the first top 4 or 5 colleges in India. If they're looking for, if they're a fresh out of school person, if they're looking to kind of do a STEM degree, they're better off kind of preparing for JEE and kind of going to great colleges like BBP and DCE and NIT and everywhere else, right? But yeah, if you're essentially saying that I want to do culinary arts, I want to do automobile, I want to do film, I want to do space, I want to do, luxury fashion studies, I want to do brand marketing, so on and so forth. Then of course, it will be a much better option to kind of go to schools who are best at this, because in India, in the domestic ecosystem, we don't have schools that focus on stuff which is outside STEM. Then again, within STEM, we have enough people who essentially want to focus on more research and kind of stick onto those areas. For example, we see a lot of people in India, while they do engineering, they will eventually jump onto a management degree and then after that, they will be doing finance, right? So no correlation whatsoever with the mechanical or electrical engineering that they did in their undergrad. And then no correlation whatsoever with what they did in their MBA and then doing something which is completely different as they start their career. But yeah, if you are looking to kind of pursue that mechanical engineering and you want to focus on more research, you want to do a master's around it, then of course, the very fact that the research out there is far more fantastic, the very fact that you are taught by professors who sit on the boards of Fortune 500 companies, that makes a hell of a difference. And in that case, you're kind of better off studying in those universities. So there is no one better than the other. In current circumstances, if you ask me, if I look at this from another lens, my very biased view, as a platform, we help Indian students get to universities in both India and abroad. We have a lot of people who essentially, we have a large set of people who kind of stick back in India. We have a large set of people who go to different countries. India is the second highest country by volume that our students go to. You can guess the first one. But in the current circumstances, from what we're looking at right now, very unfortunately, I think the cases are rising exponentially in India at the moment. And there are countries who have kind of been able to flatten their curve. For example, just to kind of talk about the number from yesterday, we saw that there were 14,500 cases in India yesterday. And there were 26 cases in the UK. I'll be much more safer in the UK, given that my fee will cover my insurance as part of the National Health Scheme. And I will get a hospital bed, even if kudana kasta 0.01%, I do kind of get the virus. I'll be much more comfortable being in a country or in a New Zealand, which is COVID free, or in an Australia, which is again on the verge of kind of finishing out of COVID. So that is how I will look at it at the moment.
Of course. Yeah, safety is always a priority. Moving on, sure. That was actually a very important question for all of us because we are looking for, you know, higher education abroad mostly and, you know, famine and
there. Sure, well. Sure.
Talking about entrepreneurial journey, no one really talks about the hows of dealing with failures. But in the world of business, people face failures every day. How do you think young entrepreneurs can stay motivated upon facing such failures?
Nice, Shanshu, beautiful question. Like I said in the very beginning, I think perseverance really matters a lot. It's not just a mere word. It's actually a sentence and a paragraph and a whole book. I have had like, I think, and I won't kind of self-glorify here, but I think anybody who's kind of starting out will face enough failures. And there are different ways in which people deal with it, right? I was very lucky that I had a bunch of mentors who I could essentially cry my heart to, essentially bail out when things are going really wrong with me. And you all have to have those days where, if you've seen the Silicon Valley show, where we would essentially lie down in a bathtub and kind of just figure out what the fuck went wrong and what should we really do from here. So of course you see all of those days, but then again, what you tell yourself in those times is that, okay, let me just survive and let me kind of just let this pass on. And you kind of fight back. Different things work for different people. For me, I think what has worked is the big plethora of resources that are out there. We have books like The Hard Thing About Hard Things, which really essentially glorifies failure in some way and talks about how it's really kind of, it's not that difficult to come back from failure. I personally kind of, I listen to a lot of Indian rap music, which helps me kind of become more upbeat and think about things in a slightly different way. When I think I was in a 0 to 1 journey, my favorite star was Badshah. I used to listen to his rap songs. And for example, now I listen to this Punjabi rock star called Jasmine Sandlas, who's again a UK-based indie pop rock artist. So different things for different people. Could be a mix of music, could be a mix of learning from mentors, could be a mix of having the right ecosystem. And I think hence you also want to build the company alongside people who really care for you as a person too. Who you can share the ups and downs with, because that will also ease up the pressure to a very great degree. But yeah, it's not an easy journey, of course. Like I said, after the first 15 days, the glamour goes out. It's then shutter up, shutter down. And then it's about what's coming the next day. And of course, unfortunately, given we have popularized it so much in the last 5 to 6 years, and I am part of that generation which essentially was pulled in for a variety of those factors too. So I think we draw very big aspirations out of ourselves. While in the previous generation, it would have been okay to build a 30, 40, 50 crore business, which is not bad, right? If you think of it, if you're living in a good tier one, tier two city, 50 crores will do a lot of good for you. It will get you to the right house and right cars and whatnot. It's a right wealth status. And people were essentially called rich if they had 10 crores or 12 crores of wealth. But if you kind of look back and you say 10 crores, 12 crores, मतलब उतना तो आजकल seed round में और pre-series round वगैरह में race करते हैं लोग. You are not essentially wanting to exit at that space, right? You're looking to, everybody's aspiring to build a $100 million company at the least. And I think that also puts in a great set of pressure on you to kind of keep chugging along the race for at least 5 to 7 years or more. Thankfully we have people like, say, Abhijay Shekhar Sharma or Ashish Hemrajani from Book My Show, who have shown that they have kind of stuck around their business for the last 20 years, 22 years, and their heyday came like for Paytm, it came after 10 to 12 years. For Book My Show, it came after again another 8 to 10 years. I think those examples serve as great motivation for a lot of people, essentially, I think, who are playing the journey in a slightly different way, building a more cash efficient business versus building a more cash guzzling business, which again comes with its own pressures because you have to raise funds continuously to survive every 6 months. So again, this is a much larger question. This kind of deserves its own 1 hour sometime in the future.
Of course. It's just like Elon Musk said once, like doing a startup is like eating glass.
Absolutely.
So if anyone needs, you know, a lot of motivating words or a lot of motivation.
Absolutely.
So,
and I think so it
for
is.
Everyone watching. Yes.
So I think so it is for people who work at a startup as well. I think all startup executives, it is very tough to essentially, it's a much tougher environment to work at. I have worked at startups as well before starting up myself. And I think it's not easier either ways. It takes a lot of courage to essentially work at startups because it's going to be far, far, far more tougher. But again, at the same time, the rewards that come with it, you would have learned in 6 months what in a traditional world you would have taken 5 years to kind of get a grasp of. And I think those pieces are absolutely not worth trading. In fact, I would very actively encourage people who are not looking to do something of their own to very actively encourage them to work at startups for a couple of years, because it will completely change how you look at things. It will completely change how you look at solving problems. And trust me, you don't want to have any other, especially given you're part of an ESL, you don't want to essentially start off with a... when I say a startup, I very strictly mean a startup which is minus pre-series B. For the sake of clarity, I won't count an InMobi or a Paytm or a Flipkart in the guise of a startup, because again, like those are very, very well established, very well process driven companies. You will have a lot to learn there, but again, the real hustle will essentially be learned in a slightly more chaotic, slightly more earlier 3 to 5 year old company, which is still figuring a lot of things out as they go around their way.
So for all the viewers who haven't seen Silicon Valley, as Shaw said, it shows like everything that you want to know about the hustle. It's a very amazing show. You can actually watch it on Hotstar. Moving on to the next question. All the entrepreneurs took a certain amount of hit to their businesses or their own mental health. And we guess you would agree to that, you know, viewing the current situations. So what changes did you make to sustain this lockdown?
So interesting. On the business aspect, very early on launched a different product. We pivoted around the business. We launched products that were more healthy for all our stakeholders to kind of engage with. We have three stakeholders primarily. We have students. We have mentors who guide these students to get into their right careers, right universities. And then we have universities who engage with us as well, where we help them with tech tools to engage with students in a far better way. We help them increase the quality of their intake, so on and so forth. So in our case, we pivoted our business, launched new products very quickly. We moved to a completely online shop versus what was an online versus offline omni-channel shop much before the COVID era began. And I think that really served us well. I think we were lucky that we were in a sector like education, which continues to kind of be upbeat. Come what may, because it really can't stop. People really do not want to essentially take out a gap year or stop their learning in some way versus say travel or e-commerce, which have essentially suffered more hits than an education business traditionally would have. This, of course, that's on the external side. On the internal side, I think it's a great period because you try to figure out how productive you can be. You try to innovate internally on how can I make sure that hundreds of people in my company can become far more productive, far more resourceful, make far better use of their time. And hence you build processes, hence you essentially structure things in a far superior manner than you might have been doing before that, because you're always in a rush to grow very, very fast as a venture-backed company. So I think that's what happened with us. And I think in some way it's a... this lockdown has served us well in terms of making our foundation as a company internally very, very strong as well, from what it was 3 months back to what it is now, which will only kind of help us moving forward.
Great. So this is something very important that most of us wanted to know: leadership skills versus management skills. So is it enough for an entrepreneur to have one, or should he have both of them?
I have a question for you. What is the difference?
I was actually, doing this thing where a course where, you know, they were talking about management skills basically, and they very specifically said that, you know, leadership is very different from management, because manager, you know, essentially like a manager of traditional companies. I'm not talking about the startup culture. So a manager of traditional companies has to, you know, coordinate with all his people and keep them on track on their projects and stuff. But, you know, when we talk about a leader, he's the face of, like Steve Jobs. He's the face of the company. The people who are working there have faith in him. So whatever, or Elon Musk. So whatever Elon Musk dreams of, his entire company dreams of that, you know, towards fulfilling that. But, you know, there are very, a lot of managers over there who manage the small stuff going over there. So they said very specifically that, you know, it's different, but in a leader, in an entrepreneur, basically, I think that we need both of them, but, you know, I'll want your views on it.
I'm glad what you said. I'm glad you said what you said towards the end of that answer. So yeah, I have read this in books as well, that leadership skill is different from management skill. Though I think the differences are very few, and the right combination essentially is a mix of both of them, right? Like, you can of course say leadership is in some way inspiring the entire org to believe that you can do it, to essentially achieve the unachieved. And management will be kind of go out and achieve those goals one by one by putting a structure around it. But leadership does not essentially work around very well without management, and management does not work around very well without leadership. Let me kind of put some emphasis on the examples that you gave, right? While you rightly spoke about Steve Jobs' leadership, but I think Steve Jobs was a much better manager as compared to being a leader, right? Steve Jobs had Johnny Ive, who was the best product builder, product designer in a generation, in his team. Johnny Ive had the best operations guru that anybody could think of. Johnny Ive had, who's the current CEO of Tim Cook, right? He had a Johnny Ive, he had a bunch of these, a supremely, if you read the Steve Jobs biography, right? He had a supremely talented A team, and his bigger talent always was, if you look at the beginning of his career, and if you look at the second journey, starting the 2000s as well, starting late 1990s as well, when he introduced the Mac and then iPhone happened. His biggest talent was bringing the best people on board and then delegating this in the best possible way, and then kind of inspiring these guys to kind of keep thinking bigger and bigger and better and better. So in some way, he was the best possible manager out there. Again, for Elon Musk, that's again an example that he gave. If you saw what happened, the launch that happened, and they sent two people to space recently, about 1 or 2 weeks back, right? If you look at the videos around that, Elon Musk has a star-studded team, even in SpaceX, right? A coterie of 5 to 8 people who are just the best in what they do. And Elon Musk's role there is to essentially, because the guy thinks differently, the guy is a big risk taker. He can essentially make them imagine stuff that they aren't able to. But I don't think Elon Musk will be able to do things in a better way than these six guys will be able to. Same way, or Steve Jobs will be able to do ops in a better way than Tim Cook. Or Steve Jobs will be able to design products in a better way than Johnny Ive. Their job is kind of more leadership driven, and their job is kind of more... So one can't essentially work without the other. And at some scale of the company, essentially, you would need the best mixture of both of those ideologies. And yeah. That's a short answer, of course.
Yeah.
You need a combination of both of the things. You really can't do.
So, moving on, we'll be... Of course. Okay, thank you. And we'll be taking some questions from the audience. So, if anyone has to ask, you cannot unmute yourself. So, if you have a question, you can just raise your hand and we'll unmute you. Or you can just type it in the chat box and we can unmute you. For all that,
awesome.
I have one question.
Thank you, everyone.
Yes, I have one question. We heard you say 0 to 1 a lot of times. So is 0 to 1 a book that you'll, you know, refer to?
Well, I absolutely recommend. Yeah, very. It's a big favorite. I think generally, because a lot of your questions were driven around the fact that there are two parts of the journey, And I think we are, given that we are a three-year-old company ourselves, and we have, we crossed a 0-1 probably in back, and right now we are in at 1-10 phase, and then we'll, at some time, we'll get in the 10-100 phase, when we become, say, a size of an urban club or an urban company, perhaps in a, say, 2 to 3 years from now. So I think a lot of my, a lot of the questions that you asked are more relevant towards the beginning of the journey, to essentially proving your product market fit, and to essentially proving the first few customers are viable, proving that the first few sort of investors can essentially come in and put money in your business. So it was more relatable from that perspective, and hence the 0-1 usage. And of course, the game kind of really evolves as you move forward from that level.
Yeah, it changes accordingly, like as you scale up.
And you need to scale up as well, as the game changes. And hence, very, very important to invest as much time as you can in your personal growth. And if you can build that as a skill today, if you can build that as a kind of in your DNA right now while you're at college, nothing better than that.
Indeed. So if anyone has raised their hands, we can actually unmute them.
I don't see any hand raises yet. Guys, just click on the hand
raise. Yeah, Sidra, if you could unmute Sidra Jaffrey.
Sure. Sidra, you're now unmuted.
Yes. Hi. So before we start anything, for instance, not just startup, but just before we start anything, there is a big no to everything. So what is a big no before a startup? Like, what should we avoid? The main, like, main things that we should avoid doing before a startup.
Like the but in every sentence.
Yes.
Sure. So I think the big no should be, are you solving something that is relevant or not? If I'm essentially solving something which is just relevant for me and my friends, and if I essentially test it out and I see that, hey, this is not really a solution that can be viable, or I can't build a business around this, which is called a product market fit, right? Is the market adaptive of your product? Is the market adaptive of your solution? It's good to try it out. So it was much difficult to try it out, say, about 5 years, 10 years back in the day. But now, given Facebook ads, a very easy way to do it is, if I have a solution, I can just put a Facebook ad around it, put everything that I need to, and see how many people click on it. And probably in a month, I will know that, okay, there is enough interest around this or not. So you can essentially do a lot of social book marketing. You have enough tools. You can be intelligent around that. You can do Jugadu around that, like Shridhanshu said. And you can figure out whether there's a bigger enough customer base for something that you're solving for. Because the customer is the rock star, right? Like, essentially, if you have the customers, you will have the revenue flowing in. That will ensure that the investors believe in you. That will ensure that your first few employees believe in you. And from there on, you will essentially build a business. But if you build a business which is not going to be viable, which does not really solve anything for somebody out there and makes a difference in their life, then really it is not worth your time. Then essentially you might as well be solving for something else, or you might be essentially spending your time learning at another startup where you can pick up on some of those things.
Okay, so basically knowing my target audience, like what...
In some way, yes.
Yeah.
Knowing your target audience and knowing that they will pay for your solution, very specific to your solution.
Yes,
so
yes.
Make it into that as well. For example, I see enough people and more who start businesses and with a certain problem that they romanticize, and then they essentially, just because they've romanticized that solution that they want to essentially bring into the world, they stick to it and they don't essentially change their positioning. I see it with a lot of people. And then they essentially try and force fit a market around it. And that's why, so when something like this happens, that's when the business does not scale. It won't really scale over time, like so over 6 months, 12 months, 18 months. And if you wouldn't have essentially focused on those aspects right on day zero, that is a problem that you will kind of live with, and you will end up wasting a lot of your time. So very important that you figure out if it's right or not in the first month or 2 months. Mm-hmm. And if it's not right, kind of move on very, very quickly to either something else or to essentially onto your own journey of learning.
Okay. Thank you.
Cool. Thanks, Sidra. Appreciate it.
I think
there was a question on the chat.
Sure, go for it.
Yeah.
How do you build a promising customer base? So, and this is from Ishita. So, Ishita, again, depends on if you are solving for example, say, B2B or B2C. if I'm solving for, say, B2B, if I'm solving for, say, for example, I gave the Kirana example, I would literally go to every Kirana store that I can in a certain area and speak to them if I'm solving the problem for them or not. Once I know that I'm solving the right problem for them, whether it be in terms of helping them put their store online, be it helping them with the software that can help them account better, be it in terms of something else that they need, like I said, maybe organizing their inventory or anything else of that sort. So then you essentially start charging those people something which is gonna come in every single month. And if they continue paying you, say, for 4 to 6 months, you know that you have a promising customer base. Same thing for B2C, for example. In our case, we were getting students to figure out what are the right career opportunities for them, what are the right universities for them, what are the right things that they should do as they move forward in their career. And that meant that I was interacting with students myself for the first 1 year of the business and ensuring that we have a solution which is very different from anything out there, which really focuses on something that adds incredible value in their life and will kind of make them part with X cash to be able to take that value in. That is very important. You have to remember always that take the glamour out. It has to operate like a dukan. If somebody finds enough value in what you are giving out, be it a product or a service, they have to pay you. If they don't pay you, it's not a business. Yes, you can fund your business with investor money for the first 6 months, 1 year, 1.5 years. At some point of time, you'll have to monetize it. So either you have a great plan to monetize after those 1.5 to 2 years, which will be visible, which will be essentially easy to kind of figure out. For example, you can always say that, hey, you know what, I'm building content repositories. And then I'll essentially, once I have all the content together, I'll invest in content for the first 2 years. Then I'll essentially start advising these guys on their education or career or whatnot. Or you can essentially say, you know what, like I'm building this software right now for all the Kiranas. Once I build the software for the first 1 year, 1.5 years, I'll kind of pivot it around based on what these guys know. I'll figure it out with the free users and then I'll kind of do something which I'll roll it out for monetization. So you can always do those things, but you need to have a very clear plan in terms of how these customers are going to react once they have to pay for this product. Will they pay or not? Whether it be a business, whether it be a B2C customer. And I think that will essentially make sure that you are at least setting up the foundation for having a very promising customer base. I hope I answered your question.
Right. I have another from Anand Patake. He asks, how to tackle the bureaucracy while doing any business?
I don't think.
Sure. So, Anand, do you want to unmute yourself and I can give you a generic answer, but do you want to say anything which is more specific?
Yes, sir. Hi.
Sure.
While doing anything, especially in India, you have to do a lot of paperwork. You have to go through a lot. Kacheri ke chakkar kaatne padte hai. There is a lot of bureaucracy and under the table wala things that are there involved. So how do you tackle these things? I mean, especially if you are a person who walks, who walks straight and is completely... who's a man with a principle. If you're a man with a principle, how are you going to tackle the thing that a person in front of you is asking you for a bribe?
Sure. So Anand, I think 2 points.
I can actually add something.
Sure.
I can actually add to that question a little bit. So you can get something. I actually started this thing a few years back called Listen, which was essentially a mental health related startup. Where Beautiful. We, provided people a safe space to speak in. But then the problem was that, the people who were actually studying psychology or who were practicing it, they came forward and said that, it's illegal. If you do not have a certificate, you cannot do this. You cannot do that. You cannot talk to our people and stuff like that. So, a lot of people come down to close your business even before it starts because, the competition. And that is where a lot of people come in, ki nahi humko tum ye doge, so fir hum tumhara ye kaam kar denge.
Theek hai, okay, cool. So let me divide the answer into 3 aspects. Let me structure it out. First, let me kind of set some context. Second, let me speak about the specific bureaucracy you spoke about. And third, let me come to customer/the external word that Sudhanshu you spoke about. So the first one is, I think you should throw the idea out of the window that it's not possible to build a very clean business today. I think it's very much possible. You can walk a straight line and still build a great business. There are enough resources out there which essentially help you cut through the bureaucracy, register your company, file for your GST, and do all of those things which are very, very basic. So I don't think essentially you should be worried about those aspects as well. There are enough resources out there, a lot of platforms that people have started to support early stage entrepreneurs. So I'm happy to essentially post this session. If any of you are looking to start up soon enough, happy to share a list of those resources with you. We have seen the likes of Narayan Murthy build a very clean business 2 decades back, right? And go IPO and make sure that 50,000 people in Infosys created enough wealth for a lifetime and more. So I don't think it's, if you have the principles in the right place, I don't think it's very difficult to build a clean business. At least that's what I believe. I speak out of my experience of 3.5 years. That is one. Second is, like I said, second I answered, of course, right? Like I'll share these resources with you if you need any help on those pieces. There are enough people out there who are doing this for you. If you, in fact, even if you need help with term sheet and other clauses that investors will essentially spark up, you can go to platforms like AngelList and Let's Venture, which have all of these things very well spelled out. You can access resources like Y Combinator, which very clearly speak about this is how you should go about registering your business. This is how you should go about getting your first customers online. So there are enough and more resources on that aspect. Third point, which is a more twisted point that you spoke about that you added, Sudhanshu, is that, of course, yeah, there will be enough people. And I think that's where I will repeat this word for the 10th time in this conversation. That's where the perseverance kicks in, where you tell these people to fuck off and you tell them that, boss, I will do what I have to. Okay, it's illegal. Show me where it is written that it's illegal and I'll go ahead and again build it. As long as I am adding value to even one user, my business is legit and I can do whatever the fuck I want. So that's how I would essentially look at it. When Uber started, let me give you some very popular examples. Car hailing was illegal because cab unions came out and said that, boss, no, you have to get a license to be driving a taxi around. Or when e-commerce started, like even now, right? Like even during the coronavirus situation, the MSME industry per se across the country went all out against the e-commerce players and said that, you know what, you can't let these e-commerce guys open up. And that's fine. That will happen. People whose business are threatened by a disruptor will always come out against it and say that, okay, this can't happen and that can't happen. And that's also in some way a moat, if you think of it. The fact that you want to essentially lobby up the government and you want to kind of build up regulations around entering a particular business, those are also moats that you're kind of building in a business that those guys have built and they're essentially making use of right now. So you might as well go ahead and build those moats, a different set of moats in your business, which can be driven around the customer love, which can be driven around technology that you're using, which can be driven around solving the problem to the very core and having your users pay much more for it as compared to anything else, like we saw with Uber Black. So as long as the customer sees value in it, you just need to kind of make sure that you're very brave in going about your business and say fuck you to the rest of the world.
Of course. So I guess Anand's question
Thank
was
you.
Answered.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Anand. Thanks for answering the question. There's a question from Naraini.
We'll take
Mahulia.
One or two more questions.
Sure, I can take two questions. That's fine.
So the question is, due to the corona crisis, a lot of businesses are affected. How can we use the digital platforms to make them sustain during this time? That's Naraini.
Sure. Any specific business that you are kind of speaking about, Naraini, if you want to unmute and talk about it, or I can give a generic answer as well.
Naraini's...
So let me go in and give a slide. Cool. Let me give a generic answer. I see her text here. So see, again, depends on what you're building for. Let me again divide it into two very specific categories, either for other businesses or for consumers. If you're building for consumers, can you essentially make sure that your interaction with the consumer completely happens online? So let me take the example of D2C brands, right? In the previous generation saw the likes of big FMCG players like HUL and P&G, but we are seeing D2C brands come in. We are seeing that a Sleepy Owl coffee can sell coffee to a certain subsection of audience and they can love it absolutely. We are seeing that I use a hair gel and a shampoo by a company called Arata, which is a startup. And they're essentially selling from their website. So you can essentially build a D2C brand which can help you connect your audiences directly. That's for, say, or say a Nykaa, which has kind of gone out and is challenging, which is a unicorn now, which has gone out and challenging the bigger set of these FMCG players in revenue, in number of customers, in valuation, all of those aspects. Second aspect is, if you are essentially selling a more services-driven or experience-driven business, of course, it's much more easier for you to essentially come online and make sure that you change the consumer behavior around it. You should see this as an opportunity for yourself, because in a non-corona world, it would have taken you far longer to get your consumers to adapt to an online-only structure. Now, you have the golden opportunity to tell your consumers, hey, you know what, there's no other option. You might as well switch to online, because that's the way I can serve you. And that will then take care of the rest. On the B2B aspect, it's slightly harder because you still need to interact with people who are not yet online. Of course, if I'm looking to sell a CRM software to startups, or if I'm looking to sell something to large enterprises, that can happen online. But if I'm looking to essentially sell something to the underbanked or underserved, the SMEs, the Kiranas, then essentially it's going to be a slight problem, and it will have to be a mix of offline plus online, and it will have to essentially warrant much tougher turnaround. For example, maybe you chat with them on the phone and tell them to get online and tell them that, hey, this is how you can increase your business. So you have to understand that one part is building customer love, but the other part is, as long as you are doing two things, right? As long as you're kind of helping the user make more money, or you're helping the user save money, as long as those two aspects are kind of taken care of, your business will be successful. It's very tough not to build a great business then. So if you're essentially giving somebody education, if you're giving somebody, say, a CRM to essentially help them grow their sales faster, a startup, then of course, why not? Why will your business not grow? Because the consumer can easily see how you can kind of very easily grow their own individual performance, or grow their own business performance by using your resources. Or essentially, if you're saving money by being like an e-commerce aggregator and telling them that, hey, you know what, I will save your delivery costs, or by being a food delivery person, saying that I will make sure that you are able to increase your earnings, at the same time you are able to kind of decrease the spillage, decrease the cost that getting your food to a consumer kind of looks like. And then you will force fit into one of those categories of either I'm building more revenue for my customers, or I'm essentially either making them more earn more money, or I'm essentially helping them save money. And as long as I fit into any of those criteria, and I'm building customer love around it, I'll be able to kind of build a very solid business for myself. Longer answer to a shorter question.
No, it's actually fine. It was actually good for a lot of us who are working, because I am currently working with this, you know, very small case startup where we are building a base for indie-based products, like self-care and skincare products. So
awesome.
We're connecting
awesome.
With them and selling it to the consumer, because they cannot sell it straight away. We're creating an online platform for them.
Awesome.
So yeah, online is a great solution for a lot of businesses right now.
But of course, you need to, in all businesses, you need to really figure out distribution, and distribution is key.
Yes.
So you really want to make sure that you solve for distribution before you start a D2C brand, because you don't want to be in a situation where you have spent enough time in R&D and manufacturing and have something which is ready, and then don't know how to distribute it. And hence, you could spend more time in the first 6 months to 12 months on writing a lot of blogs about it, bringing a lot of chatter around it on social media, building a mini brand around it among your friends, and then essentially taking it forward, doing some SEO around it, and then essentially having a distribution kick in as soon as you launch your product, or go out on, say, websites like Product Hunt and so on and so forth, but some more experience that you're kind of selling on to prospective customers.
Okay. Samrat,
cool. Anything else?
Any more questions?
Yeah, I don't have any more questions for me right now. Disha has posted a feedback form, guys. I believe
there is, let me just take one more question before you guys wrap it up.
Okay.
There is one more question around how much great scope is there for agriculture entrepreneurs, what thing he or she should look forward to. So I think, let me just take this last one, guys, before we wrap it up. So, and this was asked by Bhargav. So Bhargav, again, I will say it's important what aspect of the agriculture is a very large space, right? What aspect of it are you solving for? Are you solving something with a farmer that is best solved with the help of multiple tools which will help them grow their crops in the right way? It could be information-driven tools. It could be communication tools. where you kind of take a percent of their profits if you're able to help them grow their crops in the best possible way. Or it could be something around supply chain where you are kind of helping procure these farmers' crops and ensuring that it is sold at the right price to the wholesalers. Or it could be further on where you're kind of basically becoming a broker between making sure farm fresh food, like a lot of people do right now, right? It is reaching maybe not the consumer directly, but at least the restaurant directly. And these restaurants are able to essentially then pay a premium for this farm fresh food brought by you in a very short duration, which will essentially mean a lot of supply chain innovation. So it depends on what aspect you want to solve for. It's a very large space. It's a very beautiful space. You've got commodity buying. You've got solving for the farmer. You've got bringing a lot of tools which can be used in the agricultural lands. And as long as you are solving something for which people are going to pay you money, it could not be the farmer directly. It could, for example, a friend of mine where I've invested runs this company where they sell bamboo straws to big hotel chains like the Oberoi's and the Tridents and even to players like McDonald's and Zomato. And they help the farmer make more money by selling these bamboo straws. And that in turn is a great business because I'm not only adding value to people who are in these restaurant businesses by giving them a substitute to paper or to plastic or to wood, but I'm also essentially helping farmers increase their income. So see about how you can kind of create more value to other humans, to other businesses. And as long as you have those pieces covered, you will be on your way to building a great business.
Great. So be it B2B or B2C, it's all about, you know, creating a good place for where everyone
building
benefits
value.
From. Yes, building value. We have put up our feedback form. Disha has sent the feedback form. I'll encourage everyone to fill it up so that we can, you know, get to know how did we do. And from our side, thank you, Akshay sir, and thank you, Samrat sir, for, you know, coordinating with us and making this possible. It was amazing to have talk to us, and, you know, and like we learned a lot from this session. Before we go, just one small thing that I'll ask from you. Give us the name of 5 books that you want every young entrepreneur to read, and tell us 5 startups that you are looking forward to in 2020 and 2021.
Okay, let me talk about the books for sure.
Yes.
I will have it somewhere. Once again, boss. So I think if I have to pick up 5 books, the first one that I always pick is a book called Shoe Dog, which is a story of Phil
Nike.
Knight, who was the creator of Nike. That's right. Then I think another nice book is The Ride of a Lifetime. It's again the Disney story. Then again, another good book is, so these are again big stories, right? If you want to essentially focus more on the technical aspects, kind of learn how to go about doing a startup, there are books like Inbound Marketing. There's one called The Score Takes Care of Itself. There's one called Measure What Matters. One called Exponential Organizations. One called Intercom, My Product Management. Then 22 Immutable Laws of Branding, Traction. They're all books that I essentially love. If you are more into the story part of it, love motivation, like I told you, Shoe Dog is a great book to start around. I love books on Indian entrepreneurs and on the Indian ecosystem. So another good book to read is The Billionaire Raj. Then there is HDFC Bank 2.0, Bhujia Barons, which is on Haldiram story, Amani and Sons, Polyester Prince, Beyond the Last Blue Mountain, which is on JRD. So a bunch of good books if you essentially focus on the stories of these Indian entrepreneurs as well.
Great. And which are the few startups that you are looking forward to in 2020-2021?
Okay, sure. So let me talk about 3 companies in which I have a larger role. I think one is a company called ProEves, which is solving for early age daycare. And they're an aggregator which helps people in Fortune 500 companies and beyond to create a safe haven for their kids. And on the other side of the marketplace, they bring around and aggregate all these smaller daycare centers and sanitize them. So in some way, it's an OYO for daycare. That's a very interesting company in which I'm a shareholder. Then there's a company called Bamboo, which I told you about, which is essentially helping people move towards ecosystem conservation and also at the same time make more money for the farmers. So again, like I told you, all my businesses that I will speak about will focus on some value for the larger society as well. And the third one is around a company which is helping stores, say a Decathlon or the big Kirana stores. You would have heard Kirana from my mouth a lot of times. That's because I was thinking about the business as well. So they're kind of helping solve them, do contactless delivery. They're helping book them slots if you want to go to a Decathlon, but you don't want to essentially wait out there. How can I essentially book a slot? And when I'm essentially waiting in my slot, can I essentially increase my sales by doing a bunch of those stuff online? Because retail will be reimagined post this corona crisis. We will not have a lot of people. I will be very uncomfortable touching the same piece of cloth that somebody else has 10 minutes before me or trying it out, right? Or same for shoes or anything else. So we need a lot of solutions which basically bring technology in to disrupt retail massively. So this is something on that. And this business is called All In, O-L-I-N. So yeah, I'm looking forward to these three businesses right now.
Okay.
With a very strong bias.
So much.
If any of you happen to be later become my mentees, I will take your name in any other session that I do.
Sure. Thank you so much, sir, for giving us your time. And we know you have been pretty busy, but then this means a lot for all of us.
Thanks, buddy. It took me a while to kind of get back to you. Really sorry about that, but thank you so much. I really enjoyed this chat.
Great. So we'll bring ending the chat, and once again thank you, sir, for the last time, because we were really psyched for this. Yeah.
Cheers. Thank you. Yes. Look forward to chatting with some of you outside the session as well.
If you want to reach sir, he is also available on Instagram and other handles, so you can reach out to him there. Thank you, everyone who joined us today.
All the best. Cheers, guys.